COP25 starts tomorrow, everyone. You wouldn't know it though, would you? It was going to be in Brazil, but Bolsonaro's a maniac and he told the UN to get lost. Then it was going to be in Chile, but there's been a lot of violent civil unrest there recently, so right at the last minute the event got moved yet again, and now it's about to start in Madrid in Spain. For the benefit of those who don't know what COP is, it's the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change Conference of Parties. They've had one every year since 1995, and it was at COP21 in Paris in 2015 that everyone made their wonderful pledges to reduce their carbon dioxide emissions. Speaking of which, this week the World Meteorological Organization, or WMO, tell us that levels of heat-trapping greenhouse gases in the atmosphere have reached another new record high. Globally, average concentrations of carbon dioxide reached 407.8 parts per million in 2018, up from 405.5 parts per million in 2017. Since 1990, the WMO tell us, those increasing concentrations of greenhouse gases have resulted in a 43% increase in the warming effect on the climate, with carbon dioxide accounting for about 80% of it, according to figures from the US National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA. And all of that information must sound very odd to millions of Americans who so far in 2019 have experienced one of the coldest winters on record at the beginning of the year, relentless rains and flooding over large swathes of the country, and most recently another big freeze with the lowest October average temperatures in a decade. So perhaps it's no wonder that many folks in the United States had some sympathy with Mr. Trump earlier this year when he so eloquently proclaimed that America would benefit from a little bit of that good old global warming. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. American farmers, especially those in the Midwest, are becoming more and more resigned to the fact that the weather is getting just plain weird in their part of the world and almost impossible to predict from one year to the next. On May the 28th, 2019, the US Department of Agriculture reported that as a result of the relentless rains and flooding across widespread areas of US agricultural land, only 58% of the corn that could be planted was actually in the ground. For soybeans, it was only 29%, and as this article by Sarah Gibbons for National Geographic points out, that's a big deal for US farmers who supply a quarter of the world's grains, a category that includes corn, wheat and rice. So why so rainy? Well, Chief of Science Services at NOAA, David Easterling, explains that as the atmosphere warms, it's capturing more and more moisture, about 7% more for every 1 degree Celsius of temperature increase. But atmospheric warming is not a thing that Midwestern farmers will tell you they're experiencing in their day-to-day lives, particularly in 2019. So how can global warming possibly account for these apparently completely contradictory weather patterns? Well, it seems that most weather presenters on the mainstream television nowadays have a default, easily remembered phrase that they can always rely on to help us viewers understand what's going on.
Well, there's more and more research connecting climate change and a warming climate to impacts on the jet stream.
But the jet stream isn't a new thing. It hasn't just been sent down to Earth by those aliens that for some reason still seem to be keeping their distance from human race. Can't think why. Now, the jet stream's always been a thing, so why are we hearing about it so much more often in the weather bulletins these days? In fact, while we're about it, what even is the jet stream anyway? One of the most respected experts in this field is Dr. Jennifer Francis, senior scientist at Woods Hole Research Center in Massachusetts. Dr. Francis explains that our planet is warmer at the widest point of its diameter, which is around the equator. We all know that one. It's why us Northern Hemisphere folks travel south for our vacations. And of course, we also all know that the coldest bits of the planet are at the point of its smallest diameter, which is obviously at the poles. And that warm air around the fat middle part of the Earth rises, because that's what warm air does. The rising air sets up a gradient between the middle of the planet and the top of the planet where the air is very cold, and the warm equatorial air moves down the gradient towards the poles. It's a thing we call wind. But because the Earth is spinning, everything in the Northern Hemisphere gets turned to the right, and lo and behold, you've got a wind zipping around the planet at about 30,000 feet above the surface, which is just about the right height to help your jumbo jet fly from New York to London much faster than it otherwise would. And so this particular stream of extremely helpful air got christened the jet stream. The bigger the difference in temperature between the equator and the poles, the bigger the gradient is for the air to travel along, and so the faster it goes. all pretty straightforward. The human emissions of carbon dioxide are causing warming in our atmosphere, and that's been melting quite a lot of the sea ice up in the Arctic. Ice is really good at reflecting sunlight, and when it melts, you're left with very dark seawater, which is really good at absorbing sunlight. That means the water warms up, which means even more ice melts and even more open water is exposed, causing even more warming and melting and so on and so on. It's one of the most significant positive feedback loops causing the phenomenon known as Arctic amplification. So while the average global atmospheric temperature has risen by about 1 degree Celsius since pre-industrial times, the temperature up in the Arctic is more than 3 degrees Celsius warmer, and it's heating up at least twice as fast as the rest of the planet. One of the consequences of that extra Arctic warmth is that the temperature gradient between the equator and the pole is much less steep, and that means a slower, weakening jet stream. We should probably lob in the polar vortex at this point as well, just to really confuse the issue. The polar vortex is a massive rotating wind that's always spinning above the Arctic during the winter. It's generally much higher up than the jet stream, up in the stratosphere at about 60 kilometers or 197,000 feet, but it does extend right down to about 36,000 feet, and so these two airflows are not completely distinct from each other. They do interact. As the jet stream slows down, it's got less sideways momentum, so it tends to meander up and down much more than it used to. And that meandering causes peaks and troughs in the airflow, with the troughs dragging colder air down to the lower latitudes and the peaks pulling warmer air up to the higher latitudes, which, by the way, is yet another warming feedback loop. And the interaction between the jet stream and the polar vortex means it can also weaken, which causes it to lose its nice, neat, circular shape and get all wobbly too. And occasionally, that can result in a sudden and dramatic collapse of Arctic weather systems, particularly over North America, which is precisely what happened in October when a massive blob of Arctic air crashed down across the whole of the United States like a freight train, bringing sub-zero temperatures to many areas. Now, there's plenty of folks in that part of the world who'll tell us that cold snaps are nothing new there and nothing to do with global warming. In fact, many believe it's all actually due to the grand solar minimum that we're moving into right now and the mini ice age that's apparently coming along as a result. That is a completely different topic, which we covered a few weeks back. You can jump back to that video by clicking up there somewhere so you can take a look for yourself. But there are three key differences in today's climate-driven cold snaps. Firstly, these weather events are happening more often. Secondly, they tend to be more severe when they do arrive. And thirdly, and perhaps most dangerous of all, they seem to be sticking around for far longer each time. The scientists call this last one a blocking event. This month, a research team at the Rice University of Houston, Texas, has published a paper in Geophysical Research Letters that reveals a strong link between the size of these blocking events and the changing characteristics of the jet stream. The team were looking for something called a scaling law that could be applied to computer weather models to make those models more accurately match what was observed in the real world. If they could do that for the past and present weather patterns, then the models would most likely be more accurate when predicting future patterns. They started with scaling laws that had already been developed to predict the size of day-to-day weather patterns, but none of the existing normal weather variables seemed to be able to predict blocking events. They ran thousands of simulations and analyzed the data using a powerful dimensional analysis technique called the Buckingham-Pi theorem, which is often used in designing large and complex engineering systems that involve fluid flows. And they just couldn't seem to get a universal law that made the models work until they tried correlating the area of blocking events directly with the width, latitude, and strength of the jet stream. Once those factors were included in the calculations, the model's retrospective predictions suddenly worked beautifully. I think it was one of those experiences that the science boffins call a eureka moment. The team have now compared their simple model results with the output of increasingly complex models of the Earth's weather, and they found that their new scaling law predicts changes in the size of future winter blocking events in comprehensive climate model simulations with remarkable accuracy. But their findings are not great news. These models predict that the area of blocking events in the northern hemisphere will increase by as much as 17% due to anthropogenic climate change. So, Mr. Trump, I'm really not sure the United States would benefit from a bit of that good old-fashioned global warming, because as well as life-threatening hot temperatures around the equatorial regions, causing drought, crop failures, and famine for millions of people, and wildfires breaking out all over the planet far more often and far more extensively than they used to, that good old global warming has also put huge amounts of extra energy and moisture into our atmosphere, which causes far more violent, life-threatening storms, hurricanes, and tornadoes around the world. And, most ironically of all, is the very cause of the Arctic blasts that are afflicting the United States in a more and more extreme way every year. Before I go, I just want to give a big shout out to the absolute legends who've shown their support for the channel in the last 7 days by pledging a monthly contribution of $3 or more at the brand new Just Have a Think Patreon page. So my eternal gratitude goes out to Tony Borlase, Dave Lilly, Ben Jackson, Rene Voss, Carl Pauls, Susan Morby, John Thompson, Murray Lisuk, Drew and Joanne Gallius, Matthias Svensson, Norman Warren, Matt W., Doug Hochulin, Charles Fox, Terry Lee Perry, Nick Densley, Murphy Muller, Barry Giles, Alok Talakar, William Zakinski, Aurelio Rosa, Marcus at Parkus, Marty Lieberman, Jason Stanley, John Higgett, Ronald Eo, Thomas Syett, Christopher Reeve, Eric Patterson and Lynn Coy, Robert Versetas, Robert Grattan Cooper, Janet Borlase, Rich E, and Alan Jones. Every one of them a superhero. If you want to get more involved in the Just Have a Think project by receiving patron exclusive content and taking part in monthly polls to select subjects that'll get featured in up and coming programs, then you'll find us at www.patreon.com/justhaveathink, and I'll leave a link in the description box so you can click straight there. And of course, you can always show your moral support for the channel by hitting the subscribe button and the little bell icon to make sure you keep up to date with the latest shows. By doing that, you'll be helping to raise the profile of the channel with the YouTube search algorithms, and that means getting the message about climate change out to as wide an audience as possible. You can do that absolutely for free by clicking on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.